Hello everyone. I would like to talk to you about unit tests. First question, who of you is doing some of unit tests? Who is doing it on the target? Okay, rest of the target, okay. So, I would like to start first and say something about what are unit tests. Why do we need them? What is difference between our embedded software and desktop software? How do we test? And some best practices on the end. So, do we dive in? What is unit test? We have function. First of all, unit test is white box. It means we know what is inside. Then, unit test is usually done by developers. They are small tests, they are fast, and then don't use some external things like in embedded UARTs and so on. We have to take them out. So, what can we test? We can test different parameters inside. We know we have this if then, and we know what is doing. We can take some different parameters and check if it is doing what we planned it to do. We also should take some parameters that are on the both end of the ranges, something like maximal int, minimal int. Zero is sometimes good case, because not everyone thinks about zero. And a few values between, because it's some random data. If it doesn't make 100% coverage, because int is a little bit big, and we don't want to test all of them. It would take a lot of time. So, how we can write unit test? We have our test, A smaller than B. We have two variables, A and B. Initialize them, test it, and we have result, if it's okay or not. Then we need some kind of runner, and we put it in main, do it, and then we have to report it somehow, and so on. It's all about unit test. This is how it's done. But as we see, there's a lot of boilerplate. We have to do this main thing, we have to register all the tests, we have here a little bit of things. Then some guys think of something like unit test frameworks, that they take this all boilerplate out of our code, and we can write something like this. For example, Google test, doing something like this, we write only assert, what is the expected value, and the actual value. Catch mark does a little bit different way. You write expression, and it will be tested. The other nice things about unit test frameworks, they give you output. It's human readable, it's there, out of the box. We don't have to implement it ourselves. And we have a lot of different outputs. I think JUnit is the most popular one. If you are using continuous integration, you can read it, it's XML. So, why do we need unit tests? First of all, we want to have better code quality. It facilitates safer refactoring. We can change our implementation and run the same test again, and to see if there are any side effects that we are not expecting, if it is behaving the same as it was before. So regression tests and so on. This is the big topic. It simplifies debugging. If we have hypothesis that our bug can be in this part of code when this kind of arguments are passed, we can write tests and we can verify. Pretty easy. We don't have to start debugging session, go there, change it by hand, and maybe we are right, maybe not. Other benefit is, when we write this test, then it's there. We have regression test automatically. If we, the second time, the same bug we have, we put it inside, we have tested for it. We will get fast answer. Provide documentation. If we don't know how we should call this function, we can look at tests, what parameters are passed, what is expected result, and we know how it works. And unit test is not only about finding bugs, it's also about design. If we think about TDD, test-driven development, there's the one important D, this middle one, driven. We think about design before we're implementing code. When we're implementing tests for it, we have to think about design to design it in testable way. It's the pretty often we write our code, then we think how we can test it, and then it's this way, no, it doesn't work, we have to write it again, and so on. When you think first about design, it's make it easier. So now we can look what's the difference between our embedded software and the desktop software. It's pretty important because we have a lot of myths. For example, our software is so small, it has to be put on a small, tiny device. We cannot use all this unit testing because it's too big. We will see. What's the difference between our software? On the desktop, we have our business logic. We have some libraries. We have operating system, some drivers, and we usually put some abstraction between that we are cross-platform compatible and so on. So what is in embedded? We also have something like business logic. We are doing some calculations and so on. It's our business logic. We are using some libraries. We have drivers. We can, but don't have to, have operating system. And we usually have abstraction in between. It looks quite similar. Then it's not so far away, one from the other. One difference, big difference is, for desktop, we have almost unlimited resources. We have a lot of RAM, a lot of place on hard disk, and so on. On the embedded side, we are limited. The other thing, on the embedded, we usually write all the drivers or hardware abstraction layer ourselves. On the desktop, usually we use drivers. There are some people that are writing drivers, but usually it's not the case. So we have registers on the bottom from the driver. We would like probably test our drivers too. So we can do it in two ways. We can run our test off target, or it means it run on our development computer on Windows, Linux, depending on what we are using for our development. We have we have native builds. We have unlimited resources in this environment because it's standard PC. We have fast execution. We don't have to flash it on the target and so on. It takes almost forever. And we don't need some extra hardware. That maybe it's beginning of the development. We don't have all the hardware that we need. This processor is not there. Our hardware engineer is doing it, or we order it. It takes forever to get, and so on. But there are some challenges. It's difficult to test drivers because we don't have registers on our platform. We have different compiler, different runtime. We have to simulate it somehow. And we have different architecture. We can have 64-bit, we have operating system, but our controller later is 8-bit. It's different. Then, let's look, how can we test? We have our function. This is a nice example. It's so-called pure function. If you put something in, we always get the same out. If you put the same data again, it will get out the same data out. It's nice to test. We can only it doesn't have any side effects. It doesn't change any global state or something like this. It's only working on the local data it became from our inputs. And testing something like this is pretty easy. We only have to run with 5 and 10, bigger is 10. It's okay. Other tests, A greater than B, also pretty easy. And we can have a lot of this whole list from the test that I listed on the beginning. We can use it the same way. So what if we have some classes? For example, we have some rectangle, it has some private data, and some public things. It's not so complicated. We don't have dependencies. It means we can test it in isolation, no problem. We can initialize it. We don't have side effects. It's only working with our local data. It's only one function there. So only working on the private things. So we can build our rectangle with high width, and we get result. Pretty easy. Now it will get a little bit complicated. What if we have some dependencies to our components? Because usually we have something. For example, we have our sensor, and our sensor is some external sensor is using UART, for example, as communication. Then we need to, it's this communication through UART. If you want to take real hardware, it will be slow. We need hardware, and on our host platform, UART is a lot different than on the real hardware, and we have to re-implement and so on. It will be difficult. Instead of doing something like this, we can use TestDouble. It's our fake UART that is running from RAM and giving us some data. When we run with TestDouble as dependencies, we are running in isolation. We can set state of this, and we know exactly what values we will get back. If we are using a real sensor, we get some data. If it's temperature sensor, it depends. If it is summer, then you will get 28 degrees. If it is winter, you get 20, and then it's difficult to test. This is our deterministic behavior of the test. And we can also simulate errors. This is really difficult to do when you have a real sensor. How you put some wrong data or corrupt data in there? You have to do some strange things. It's possible, but it's really difficult. So, how we introduce our test double into our sensor? Michael Feders defined something like SIM, a place where you can alter behavior of your program without editing in that place. It means that we have to introduce some SIM that we can change for our test, but for our runtime, it will be the same class with different behavior. So, how we create test double for our UART? First, we look at our sensor class. It has here this UART communication interface. And then we have get value. It sends one command to you through its communication interface to get value, and then we will get two times one byte with data. It's 16-bit value that we are getting back. And we put it together in our temporary and then give it back. Pretty straightforward. But its problem, it's there. It's not a pointer, we cannot override it, it's difficult. Our UART is only two methods, send and write and read. So, difficult to replace. We can use preprocessor or linker, it's possible to introduce this SIM. If it's our code that is already in production, this could be the way. But if you are writing new code, there are some better possibilities to do it. We can refactor it to use pointer or reference at this place, or we can use template. We will see both of them. So, this is our problem UART. What can we do with it? We can refactor it to pointer reference. So, we need for this interface, virtual interface abstraction, with our two methods, send and read. And then we can put on this place this interface with communication interface as reference. And then we have to initialize it. It means we have to add constructor that will take the implementation of this interface and put it on the right place. It's doable in this way. The other one is we can use template. So we leave our class as it was. We change this UART to our UART template, and we initialize it with default parameter as our UART. It means we don't have to change our code, production code that is using this UART. Only for test, when we want to test it, we can give extra parameter, and we have our double in place. We have to look what we want to achieve. If we have design that can get our sensor can get a sensor from only from this from UART, then maybe it's not good to add this interface. Maybe this will be a better way. If we are by design need this interface, then it's okay. Everything is good. We have to, depending on the case, we have to choose between these two methods. What is better for us? If we only want to do this for testing, probably template is better solution because it doesn't add this extra level of abstraction with virtual functions. So, exactly, yes. Here we must have virtual methods. No virtual methods, but when we compile it and we have some error, we will get nice template error, or a little bit less nice, depending. And refactoring of this thing, automatic refactoring of this thing, it's not really possible because all EDS don't work well with templates and they don't know all the dependencies and so on. So it's a little bit more of handwork. So let's can we look what kinds of test doubles do we have? There are actually two main of them. They are stubs and mocks. Stubs are only predefined classes or methods that give back some predefined data. We don't have to check behavior of this stub. We only can say it will only give 5 back or something like this. We don't know how much times and so on. With mock, we can insert some behavior. We can say our mock will be called 1 the first time, then I will give 5, second time, 10, and so on. So we'll try to introduce test double in our code. I choose this method. It will be similar to if you use templates. I choose this with interface. Oh, I forgot to add here something. Okay. Then we implement our stub first. We have our stub with our two methods. Send is only there. We have to compile it, and it must be there. It must satisfy our UART interface. And when we call read, we always return 5. Now we can write some test case for our getValue function. So first, we create our stub. Then we pass it to our sensor, and then we can try sensor get value. Here we are getting two times read, it expands to 5.5. Problem is, we don't know if this send occur or not. It's difficult to check. And if it's the real 5 is the first 5 is the on the right place or on the other way? Or if you put it in the right way together, it's not clear. And if send was there, if it was on the right position, maybe we made first read and then send. We cannot test in this way. We can try to move now to mock. For this example, I'm using Google Mock as mocking framework. Then we have our mock. This is how Google Mock defines mocks. We have method 1, it says that our method takes 1 argument. Method 0 takes no arguments. And here we have the signature of this method, and these are the names. This is how Google Mocks works. Different mocking framework might make it a different way. Then we can add our test case. On the end, we want to check if our value is 1, 2, 3, 4. So we want to have 2 different bytes that we are getting back. So first we expect call to our read function. Now we are configuring our mock, what should be done. It should happen exactly 2 times. On the first call, we want to return 12 hex. On the second call, we want to return the other part. But we still don't know if this our send was there. So we add our expectation that send should be first one with get value exactly 1 time. But we still don't know if this is the right order, because we're now only expecting this call, but it's nothing about which one will be first one. We have to add some in sequence object. It's defined by Google Mock. It's how it works. It must be there, then we know all the calls must be in this sequence, inside this block. And then We have our test. We tested the whole thing of the if these calls are in the right order and so on. So small. Now you can do small demo of the whole things that you had, that you saw. For this demo, I'm using Visual Studio. But why not? Oh, it's almost readable. Maybe I will try to make it a little bit better. Oh, kind of. Maybe, but where?
In Fire?
I'm not Visual Studio specialist. Fourth class. Account settings. There? Nee. That's not something, somewhere. Okay. I hope it will be kind of readable. So, we have here our UART interface. And we have our sensor. This is the right one with reference constructor. And somewhere below, we should have our function. We want to test this code. It's exactly as it was on the presentation. We have our tests. First with stub. And we can test this one. And then we have our mock. We have to add some extra using so that it knows where to find everything. I have also here this old test about our test, our max function from before. And we can run it, and it should work. At least it worked yesterday. And in this output, we can see and almost see there. There, not really see. Okay. Something like this. Now we can see that all tests are passed. We have summary on the bottom. Whoa, wrong one. Once more. We have summary of the bottom, all tests passed, six assertions within six tests. I am running here this verbose output from catch. It's you can see here with almost see. This is the call with require max with some big number. I think it's maximal int. And with one, and it should be this bigger number. And here you can see expansion of both sides. First one is this one, second is this one. They are the same. Everything is okay. I like this expansion with catch. It's pretty easy to see. You don't have to remember which one is the expected, which is the actual one, and so on. You can see it this way. So, I can go. So, if we look at our software, now we tested this thing. Our sensor class in our business logic, we tested up to abstraction for our UART. So, what about this thing? So usually it's we are writing our HAL for our own, or we use some generator. Who is testing HAL in unit test fashion? Okay, not so much. Okay, now we can look how can it be done on host. Oh, we need to create test double for our CPU, for our registers, because we in our code we are using them, so they have to be there. Registers are only some pieces of memory at some special addresses, so it's pretty easy to only put them somewhere and use pointers or something like this to use it. Unfortunately, some registers are read-only, some others write-only, some has some special functions, side effects. You have to look at all these things. For example, ARM has some registers that if you write to them, something else changes in some other part of memory. We have to take this in account. We can use simulator for this. Then we have this whole behavior of registers there. But simulator can be expensive. If it's first is maybe it's not there. It can be available for our platform. Don't have to. Can be expensive. Can be open source. If it's working as we expected, then it's okay. If not, then we have a problem. And it doesn't work exactly as MCU. So now I will try to show you how we can do it a little bit manually without using simulator to use it in our unit test framework. So when you look at kind of definition from our vendor, this is from MSP 430. They are using these nice unions to define some registers with some unspecified things. So it doesn't compile. No chance. So we have to change it. They're using some global anonymous unions. They are not also not so standard conform. So we have to take care of it. The most important parts of this are actually only these two things, so the buffers and these two things. And we have to take them out and do something. First, we can try to make stub that it will compile. So we make union. We define both of them. That is have the same behavior. We can use both of them. Unfortunately, then we are not allowed to use global anonymous unions. We have to then they have to be static, and it doesn't work because in different compilation units, it doesn't work. We have to put it in our implementation file somewhere and use extern. Then we have this data, and use some preprocessor magic to define exactly the same name for our stub. It works. It can be done. Then first our code will compile. We have all the definitions that we need. Oh. But what if we want to know how many calls we made to these registers, or we want to have some history about it. It won't work with this approach. We only get last value. We are lucky. C++ have some nice operator overloading. We can overload also some cast and so on, and use the facility of implicit casts to put some other object inside and to register all of the things. We can use assignment operator. Then we have history of all the calls write calls. We can use the cast operator when someone is reading it to cast it to other format. If we know what is the expected format, then it will work. In this example, I am using the reference operator. One nice thing about it, it works both ways. When I'm returning it on the left side, it will, as reference here, it will write to it. On the right side, I will have reference and I have value. Problem is, I don't have the exact history. But it depends on the use case. We have to play with different operator overloading on this place. And then we have to also do some preprocessor magic, and it works. So you can look at it. It's a result. It worked. It's on my display. Okay. First, maybe we look at the code. This is the old one. It's the implementation file. I have the test double for both of them. This is my register implementation. Maybe I can close this one a little bit longer. So I have here my first stub version for TXBuff. I have this union with both of them, this preprocessor magic and with extern. And this is my reference operator overloading for this one. Now in test, I can use this register directly to write value inside. It's register buff, then I will get it back when I'm getting you after it. And I'm initializing here on the bottom a takes buff to zero that I can check if it changed. I'm doing send, and then I can check if this is in send buffer. If I use some more, some operator overloading on this place with assignment operator, then I can maybe put it in some vector or something like this, and I have the whole history of what I was sending through this buffer. It would work. I tried in one project, it's working. We only have to look how we combine the read and write, and that we can have this order. We have to make some list with I called read, I called write, and so on. So I think I put not key. No, not this one. So now we tested this one. And before we tested this one. So next step could be we test the stack hole through. It will be integration test. We can use similar techniques to do this. It depends on the how much we want to test. And sometimes when we need some certification and so on, we need to do something like this. It's possible. Now, we tested it, everything on our 64 bits Intel computer. So, how we can test it now on our hardware? What challenges do we have? What have we do to port it to this one? We don't have console. It was nice to see all the results. It's difficult to do it with embedded. There is nothing. We have no file system. We cannot write any file. We have limited resources. And probably we have to change a little bit our unit testing framework that it works with some different interfaces. Some unit testing frameworks support redirecting output. For example, we can use UART, ARM, at least M3 and M4 has SVO, single wire output. We can use this one. And probably there are a lot of different interfaces that we can use. You can even use network if you want. It's a little bit more overhead. It's possible. For example, in Clang, we have definition. We can change when we set this define. We can change this for these streams and then put our implementation on the back and use it. So I did it, and we can look. I use for this example STM 32F4, and we can see how it works. Now we can switch to, I think it's there. Oh, better. Yeah. So we have to define some things that catch needs. It uses streams, then we have to implement some kind of stream and give it to catch to use it. This is pretty naive implementation, because I am only using here this sync. It means it is still using the whole buffers from this from standard stream and so on. So we have some heap overhead and so on. You shouldn't do it in production like this. But for this example, it will work. So we are taking all the characters from our buffer, and we are sending through SVO. This is pretty straightforward, pretty easy to do. Then we have to define for catch these three outputs. Console out, console log, and console error. I'm using here my string, my SVO buffer for those two, and for this is the same as this one. And it's everything that catch needs to work. So now we have catch with SVO output. We also need to give it some main, because the standard main doesn't work exactly for embedded, so we have to put it our way. I added here some helper functions. They're only for that I can use my target here. It's with Ethernet. And I also added here this full test as true, otherwise I will get only the 6 test passed or something like this, and then we get the verbose output. I'm using here only this test for max function, this one. So this is pretty easy. Our rectangle. And I'm not using this whole thing with registers and so on, because I have registers there. I cannot use my doubles and so on, because I have redefinition then. It's not possible in this case. But I can use real registers, but then I have real UR there. It is difficult. If you don't use the standard header, maybe you can use it also in this doubles and so on. And you don't have redefinition. If it's only in header data file, you have different CPU, different header, can be something different. You have to check it. Oh. I build it already because it takes a little bit of time. Okay, I can send it to this box. It will start execution. Maybe some of you can see there's some orange, yellow thing. It's running. Unfortunately, most of the thing that is taking time, it's flashing, because of the framework is not so small and they have a lot of overhead. And now you can see all of the results. So we have all the tests almost exactly as on the PC. It's possible. There are some challenges, but if you make them, you have to do it only once. When you have all the frameworks there and everything is there, then you can do it. You can write new tests and so on. So. And the question is, if I can test it on my desktop, why should I test it on the hardware when I have to make some extra effort to do this? And there are some things. We have different, you can have different sizes of variables. Depending on your target architecture, you can have 8-bit int, 16-bit int, on something like this. Here I have 64-bit int. Overflows and so on is different. Alignment can be different. Is your architecture MSB or LSB? It's also different. We are using exactly the same toolchain as we will use later for production. We can have some compiler bugs. We can have some hardware bugs. Can happen. On our desktop, we won't see it. So, on the end, some best practices about unit testing. Test only one thing. It's really important. If your test has about 60 assertions, and it's probably a little bit too long, you want to be your test to show you exactly what is wrong with your code. If you are making one change and 50% of your tests are red, it's not really good, because you have to search what is wrong, why it is wrong. Your test should be independent. It means you can run them in. It doesn't matter if the first test is this one or the other one. They should run independently, because then you don't have these data dependencies. If you set up a register and then you use this register in the other test, and someone changes it, it will be difficult to find. Test should be short. If your test is 500 lines long, something is not so good. You shouldn't put some ifs, fors, and so on in test, because it's difficult to see what the test is doing. And one pretty important thing, don't over mock. When you have 20 mocks and only 3 lines of verification, it's maybe something wrong with your design. The best scenario is you have only one mock and you use stubs for everything else that it can compile. Then you can verify behavior exactly of this one thing. And you should add your test to continuous integration, that you will get feedback as fast as possible. Because sometimes you change one part of code and something else breaks. So, thank you. We have some time for questions.
Now, this binary, as you probably need to compile with exceptions and stuff.
Yeah, this is the other thing with this framework. Yes, I need exceptions. You can look at it. This is this this one. It will be 700k about. In most of this framework, if you want to use it in production, maybe you have to make some more changes in framework to optimize OA or use different framework. You have to evaluate which one is good for you.
Without Google Mock, that is.
Yeah, this is without Google Mock. This is some extra.
Thinking about it, which one would you recommend personally? Google Mock or Libshop test frameworks?
I'm not a fan of mocking frameworks.
Of the unit test frameworks, which one do you prefer?
I prefer Catch because of the output and the syntax. You write in your C++ language, I would like this to be equal to this one, or this smaller than that one. I don't have to use assert equal, or assert smaller, assert bigger, or something like this. You write only require A smaller than B in C++ way, without extra DSL in between.
Using catch, you need something if you want to mock, right?
Yes.
Just catch doesn't provide
one. No, you have some other mocking frameworks there. You can look. I wouldn't probably recommend HippoMox for embedded because it's working on the kind of undefined behavior. Yes.
How far do you go in stubbing or mocking the register implementation of the chip? Do I imagine that takes a lot of time if you have like a bigger program for your entire chip or you have multiple
chips? Entire chip in a few seconds. You only have parser, it goes through all the header data and you have it. With mocking, you have to invest some time in logic and so on. But as I said, you shouldn't mock too much, then you only make a few mocks that you need.
Okay. The demonstration with the UART test were kind of simplified tests.
Mm-hmm.
Praxis, when you are receiving, you're not forwarding all the time. You're using interrupts, you're using DMA. Do you have any experience with this kind of testing?
Interrupts are pretty easy. Interrupt is only function call. This is with DMA, it's a little bit complicated. You have to set this register and copy this data from one part to another. But then you have, but on the end of DMA, you have also interrupt with I am ready. You can hook to this interrupt and run this function when you have this data there.
Okay, then you have your buffer elsewhere, you have special data, so it's kind of a little bit more complicated.
Depends what you want to test. If you're using DMA for UART, then in your application you have some buffer when you want to write this data. You can put this data in your buffer right away and only start your application code. Do you want to test the DMA or you want to test your application code? It depends.
Your center is, and the implementation is using DMA interrupt. I was looking for how did you then?
It will be tricky.
You mentioned at the beginning OS and bare metal software, but most of the examples you provide are just mere bare metal. Working with OS, part of the drivers you're trying to mock in the build is in the OS, you have binaries and includes. You don't have access to the source files to manage. How do you do that? Or how would you do it?
It depends what you want to test. Do you want to test the OS part, the drivers, or you want to test how your application is talking to OS? Which part?
The application, for example.
Then you have this abstraction. Usually you have, usually you have this abstraction in between. From business law, you can test up there. And then here you have this property binary drivers. So you can test your business logic up to here. So the question, do you want to test the drivers that your vendor supply or not?
If I'm going to try the drivers, how would I do this in your opinion?
It depends. It depends on the driver, how it's implemented. Maybe it would be possible to do some linking things to put some mocks at the link time. It's possible. You can, instead of linking to some register library, you put some other library that are providing the right interface. It depends on the driver. There is no generic solution for such things. You have to look exactly what is the problem. Oh, such fast. Okay, I'm there.
Yeah, I was thinking that everything you have covered, but you never talked about coverage part.
You could for tests on this machine, it's not a problem. You can use all the tools that you have for standard development, for desktop development. You can use GCC coverage or something like this, the GCOF or something like this. For embedded, you could try to talk to Zegert. They have some things. It could be possible, I think. And from the lighting talk from yesterday, it could go pretty well. But I don't have a solution for this.
If you change the implementation detail, it will break your mock test. You will have to modify the mock, and it sounds to me like you will have to modify your mocks all the time. It sounds like a lot of additional effort.
That's why I don't like mocks. That's why I don't like mocks. Now you should test your, you shouldn't test your implementation. You should test your functionality. This is a little bit trade-off.
If you don't like mocks.
When you have one mock per test, then you can do it. It depends on your architecture, how it is, all your dependencies. How to approach this? If you have a piece of code, you have to look at it in isolation. You are only want to test this one class, or you want to test go a little bit in integration test level, and to maybe to don't mock everything, but use the real classes. If they're only computing something, then you can use them. It's not a problem. You don't have to mock everything or stop everything. You have to mock or stop things that are going outside, for example, UART or something like this. If they're only data classes, you can use them and initialize them with data, and then it's there. You don't have to mock them. Then you don't have this overhead of a lot of mocks. You use your real code in this place. Another benefit would be you test this as integration test. Maybe going one level higher would be solution for you.
Yeah. So if you use real code, it's not really unit test anymore.
Yeah, it's one level higher, but it's this line between unit testing and integration testing. It's not so. It's a little bit blurry. Yes.
And about these mocking frameworks, how much is it useful in like? Can you always use these mocking frameworks, or do you have to write your own mock sometimes?
It depends. if you have mocking frameworks, you can only use if you have this virtual interface. If you are using template, then you have to provide your objects. Maybe you can generate them somehow, but it's usually for the you have this you need this virtual interface in between. Paul, you? No.
Yeah. More of a recommendation for testing on targets. I have had great experiences using Unity.
Mm-hmm.
It has the limitation that it is a C
mm-hmm.
library, but the only thing that makes
this one.
The point is that you can,
this one.
For example, use exception. You can test your exceptions that you probably not use in a C++ embedded environment anyway. And you have to manually add your tests. They also have, I believe, CMOC.
Yes, CMOC.
And some things
for this
that.
One.
So if you're going to go for embedded on a very small target, I've had great experiences with Unity.
As they are also using some for the CMOC, they are not using this kind of Google Mock stuff. They have some generator. I think it's in Ruby that they are using. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And then they are generating new types for it. And I think they are using the link time substitution to do this.
Yes, they are auto generating the marks, etc. So it's quite good. Then use kind of things automatically.
So, as I see, now we have break. So, thank you very much. If you have questions, I'm here today or later at the event. So, thank you.